It's very good to welcome you all to St Mary's this evening and to those who are joining us on the live stream at home for this concert, An Evening Mood. Before I hand over to Sofia to introduce this evening's programme, some words about COVID-related housekeeping. Please do wear your masks throughout the performance. There will be a 20-minute interval when we do ask that you go outside into the churchyard to help us keep the movement of air in the space midway through the performance. So we're blessed by a fine evening, so please do take some time to gather in a socially distanced way in our beautiful churchyard this evening. I also ask you, when you're moving through the building, to not walk through our central aisle. That will mean that we're not disturbing the technical equipment this evening. And that applies to our performers as well as to you as members of the audience. I'm now going to hand over to Sofia, who will say a little bit more about this evening's programme and introduce our first piece. Thank you so much, Sofia, for all the work that you've put in and the other performers tonight. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much for coming to tonight's concert. The theme of this concert is Eastern European and Nordic folkloric and classical music. And the first piece we're going to play from the programme is Old Rhinelander from Sondala. This piece is based off a Norwegian traditional melody, but was arranged for string quartet by the Danish quartet themselves. Thank you very much, and we hope you enjoy the concert.
Thank you. Scriabin's Fantasy, 28 in B minor.
Thank you. Ta-da! I was not to start with a moment of comedy. It might be as good as it gets. Hello, good evening. And for our viewers overseas in other territories, wherever you are, bonsoir, guten Abend, buonasera, and good afternoon. Hello, everyone. Nice to see you all. I can almost see you all. What a lovely evening to be coming together to make some music. And it's a delight to be able to share something with you this evening. When Sofia first asked me if I would contribute something towards this evening's music making, I was, of course, humbled and flattered. And then she announced what the theme of the music would be, Eastern European and Nordic folkloric and classical. And I thought, well, I'm not really very used to standing up like this and singing solos anyway, so I don't have much repertoire to draw on. And sure enough, I went to have a look to see if I had anything that would fit the bill, and the cupboard was indeed bare. So I had a think, and I discovered that Jean Sibelius, the celebrated Finnish composer, as we know, it did in fact have a huge output of songs which he composed based upon Swedish text. Because Swedish was, as it turned out, was the language of his youth. So he was more comfortable writing for Swedish text. Now, you may think, well, how does that make it easier? Well, I think we would all probably expect Finnish to be quite a mouthful if we don't know Finnish. But as some of you might know, I have a smattering of conversational Swedish up my sleeve. So I thought, well, that's my way in. And sure enough, I ordered, Amazon delivered, and I had a look and thought, I'm good to go. Or was I? Because it turns out my little bit of schoolboy Swedish, or just the foot, was in fact just the foothills of the mighty language. And in fact, I have a rather sweet little story to tell. When I was first in Stockholm at my then girlfriend's new flat that she just moved to, she discovered a problem with the toilet. And she phoned her father in Gothenburg and said, Papa, du måste komma fixa min toilette. And it was at that moment that I realised that learning Swedish wasn't going to be quite so daunting as I expected it to be. Papa, du måste komma fixa min toilette. However, once I had started having a look at the great text of this chap called Mr. Runeberg, who's written the text of this first song, I realised that that little phrase wasn't going to get me very far. I'd need to have another dredge my memory banks for how to pronounce some really quite tricky poetical Swedish. But it's been great fun to learn this song. This song is a wonderful little folk tale, and it tells, as all the greatest folk tales do, of passion and betrayal. And it's a song of a young lady, a girl, who returns home from a tryst with her lover. And her mother says, why are your hands so red? And she says, they're red from my lover's hands. And she comes back from the next time they have this romantic meeting. And why are your lips so red? They're red from my lover's lips. And when she returns the third time, her mother says, why are your cheeks so pale? Well, then we come to understand that, and as she says, Mother, you must dig a grave for me and put me in the grave and put a cross above the grave and inscribe upon the cross, this is the tragic story of the girl who came home with red hands and then with red lips and then with ashen cheeks because of her lover's falsehood. The final word, seen Elskans otro. Elska is a beautiful Swedish word meaning to love. Elska. And älskling, which you'll hear me sing a few times, älskling is darling or lover. Otro, untruth, is the last word. Her lover's untruth is falsehood. Other words, I'll give you a little glossary of a couple of things which may help you out. Flicka is a lovely word meaning girl. So you hear me talk about the flicka a few times. And she comes home from her älsklings mörter. Mörter is the word for tryst, a lover sort of romantic get-together. And then the other words, you can hear röda händer, red hands. Röda läppar, red lips. Otherwise, I'll just have to hope that you kind of get the gist of what's going on. I slightly mistold the story. So her mother says, "Why are your hands red?" And she says, "I pricked my fingers on a thorn." She says, "Why are your lips red?" And she said, "Because I was eating raspberries." Yeah, I got hallon. Anyway, I won't bore you anymore with a translation of this song. I'll just get on and sing it, I think. This title, Flickan kom ifrån sin älsklingsmöte. A girl came back from her lover's tryst. And I just got a little swig of this. Okay. Something a little lighter. Sibelius was commissioned to write some music for a production of Twelfth Night in Helsinki in 1909, and he wrote, so the famous songs from Twelfth Night include this one, and you may see from your programmes, Hey Ho, the Wind and the Rain. I rather love the Swedish for Hey Ho, the Wind and the Rain. Holy Lord, ut I storm och I regnet. Storm and the Rain. Holy Lord, isn't that wonderful for Hey Ho? And you'll hear that come back and back. Join in if you like. Holy Lord, ut I storm och I regn. I'll sing a bit of Swedish, then I'll sing the English translation, so you can maybe sort of see how it fits together, and then a little bit of Swedish again. Hey ho, the wind and the rain. Thank you, Anna.
Och när som jag var en liten smådräng. Håll i låt i storm och i regn. Nå var med en bänk med en utsikt bort i regnet, men regn jag var en viga dag. Men när jag som karvar i hela ens mot, håll i låt i storm och i regn. Stänge en bar för julen sin port, för till regnet, det regnet var eviga dag. When that and I was a little wee boy, with a halo, the wind and the rain. No foolish a thing, it was merely a toy. For the rain, it rained, it rained, it every day. But when I had come to a manly estate, with a hail, the wind and the rain, its knaves and against these men shut their gate. For the rain, it raineth every day. Och när som jag var en liten skådren, håll i långt i storm och i regn. Där var med en bänk och mer än en säng, för till regn, det regnet det var
called Fragments. There are sort of five, I guess you could call them sort of mini movements, each one in quite a different character. The first is called Waltz. The second is called Solitude, which strikes me as a slightly ironic name for a movement of an ensemble piece, but there we go. Third is called Holiday. Fourth is called Reverie. And then the finale is called Exit.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Next on the programme, we will be singing two short songs by the Norwegian composer Edvard Grieg. Grieg, who was born in 1843, wrote these works as his Opus 30 in around 1877, which was 2 years after he wrote his masterpiece, the Peer Gynt Suite, which I'm sure you all would know if you heard it. It was during a time when nationalism was very much on the rise. You had composers such as Smetana, who was a Czech composer who wrote many nationalistic works, as well as Sibelius, who you heard from Steve earlier. And so I hope you enjoy these two works. We will be singing Aftenstimmung, which is Evening Mood, and The Bear Hunter 2, two short songs that make up a collection of 12 that he wrote for male chorus originally, but with slight adaptation tonight. So I hope you enjoy.
Musiker auf Tennis Artenet, mit vielen Röhnen, wo es Gott und Liebe. O liebes Taus, Herr, o Wind, die Fred, till Rolli zu Männer
Der von vornen Hände war lang.
We are going to open up the second half with Rachmaninoff's Allergiac Trio. Now, he wrote this in 1892, and it was performed 2 weeks after it was written. And if we use our brains a little, that means the trio that played it only had 2 weeks to practice. And so, for the sake of that, we have only rehearsed for 2 weeks. And we will now be performing it for you, and I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
Dvorak's Moravian duets. He composed quite a few of these, and he composed them while he was employed as a music teacher in Prague. This one is quite a playful cat and mouse chase between two people who keep running away from each other, but always finding themselves going back to each other, and then eventually realising that they can't live without each other.
The fourth movement from Mieszkowski's sixth string quartet in G minor.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we come to our grand finale. I'd just like to say a few words, first about Rachmaninoff and this piece, and then about one or two other things. We've already had a piece by Rachmaninoff in this concert, a trio elegiac, and it struck me that the word elegiac could apply to everything that Rachmaninoff wrote, really. He was nostalgic or elegiac for not only his own mortality, which featured in every single work he wrote, even the supposedly happy ones, but also for the dying of the Russia that he knew very well, and particularly when he wrote the Vespers in 1915, it was clear that the writing was on the wall in all sorts of ways. And he deliberately went back to the music of his childhood, the ancient modes of the Russian Orthodox Church, and he built them into this marvellous piece, the Vespers, which of course is a celebration, if you like, of the dying of the light. And this particular piece, Gladsome Light, is particularly featured on that light that's dying. So it's great that we're seeing it now, just as the light is dying. We did all the Vespers in this church, apart from a few numbers 10 years ago. It was one of the great experiences of my life, really, to do it all. And one of the numbers we didn't do is the one we're going to do now, which Sofia's picked, so good to fill in the gaps. That's the first thing. I'd also like to just talk a little bit about this concert, because it's great that after goodness knows how many years of organising concerts in the church, I haven't had to do anything in this, apart from the odd bit of stage management. And it's all down to Sofia here, who has pulled together the programme, and I know how difficult it is. You know, music making is only 10% about the music. It's 90% about getting everyone in the right time at the right place. And that's, you know, herding cats is a great art. And I'm glad that someone else has taken it on, particularly younger people in the choir. Nearly everyone you've heard performing tonight is in the choir, and even the ones that aren't, I hope soon will be. So it's a great tribute. And Sofia, where's my little helper? We've got a little something for you. That's a card with lots of nice messages on it. And appearing out of nowhere is a... So here is Gladsome Light by Rachmaninoff.